From the Cronkite studios in downtown Phoenix, this is Cronkite News.
Several Arizona Democrats are calling foul. We take a look at the way bills are assigned committee at the state legislature and why they claim Republicans are leaving them no chance to impact the law. And a shutdown could be looming. Our Washington, D.C. Bureau has reaction to the upcoming Department of Homeland Security deadline and what it could mean for Arizona. And Cronkite News is dedicated to tracking the spread of heroin in Arizona. We're taking a look at a vaccine being developed that could bring heroin addiction to an end.
Cronkite News starts now.
Good evening and welcome to Cronkite News. I'm Julia Thatcher. And I'm Jamie Warren. Thanks for joining us. It's a case of using the system to the majority party's advantage. The process of assigning bills to multiple committees in the state legislature is one that Democrats have complained about for years. Cronkite News analyzed the numbers and found in this current session, almost half of Senate bills sponsored by Democrats are being doubled and sometimes triple assigned. Cronkite News reporter Angie Schuster looked at the numbers. Angie, how is this done?
The Senate president is responsible for assigning bills to committee. A bill has to make it past each assigned committee before it has a chance to be heard on the floor and possibly become a law. The more committees a bill is assigned to, the less likely it is to get a full Senate vote. Some Democratic lawmakers are accusing Senate President Andy Biggs of taking advantage of the legislative process.
If I want to kill a Democrat bill, I can just hold it. But I don't. I assign them to multiple committees.
A review of bills and their committee assignments in the Senate shows that bills written by Democrats have been assigned to multiple committees at four times the rate of Republican bills this session. Senator Steve Farley has introduced a bill to ban texting while driving for the past nine sessions. House Bill 2370 failed to get out of committee last week, and an effort to revive it as an amendment failed yesterday. This bill was originally assigned to three committees.
In some cases, they may assign a bill they don't like to a committee where they know the committee chair won't hear it as a way of killing the bill.
Senator John Kavanaugh has had nearly a quarter of his bills multiple assigned this session, but he doesn't see it as much of a problem.
Any bill that's multiple assigned like that is just very often a bill that has no chance of passing if it got to the floor. So it might actually be good to do that.
This strategy used in the Senate is also being used in the House by Speaker David Gowan. Many Democratic bills and Republican bills that he doesn't agree with are not assigned to committees at all. Not being assigned to committee assures the quick death of a bill.
The bigger picture says, is this a good thing for democracy?
Stephanie Grisham, the House press secretary, released this statement on behalf of House Speaker David Gowan. The speaker tries to make sure that all bills in front of him are aligned with the agenda of the Republican majority. This isn't just an issue that Democrats face. Republican Senator Jeff Dial has had six of his 31 bills double assigned this session. Senator Dial is a primary sponsor on Senate Bill 1068, which calls for additional classroom time for kindergartners. He says he doesn't expect the bill, which has been assigned to four committees, including rules, to pass.
It does take a lot of work to move through the process.
As for the large number of Democratic bills that are multiple assigned, Senator Biggs says it's just a happenstance.
There's no set idea, oh, this is a Democrat bill, let's do that.
Many of the Democratic senators and representatives I spoke with told me that the only way for their bills to pass without being assigned to multiple committees is to try again next year with a Republican primary sponsor instead. Live in the broadcast center, Angie Schuster, Cronkite News.
In some parts of the country, it's a given that school starts in September, but not here in Arizona, at least not yet. Ryan Hale has the latest on the effort to change the state's school calendar.
I just thought that was kind of crazy that they would start school before Labor Day.
There you go.
To Russell Smolden, it just doesn't make sense for Arizona's teachers and students to head back to school in the dead of summer, so the lobbyist is supporting an effort to require schools to start after the first Monday in September and end by July 1st.
It would seem to me they wouldn't want to meet in the summertime when it's the hottest part of the year. It costs a school a lot of money to cool a school building.
While supporters insist the move would save schools a lot of money through energy use.
Is it almost a wash between electricity in August and electricity in June? Maybe, maybe not.
Arizona's teachers union says there are other educational costs to consider.
We like to have a lot of instructional days before the state achievement test. And until that would have to be rearranged.
Schools all across the state of Arizona would have to make changes if House Bill 2303 is passed. But the Ball School District is one that would have to make major adjustments to its school calendar.
Ball School District is a unique school district in that we have a 200-day calendar. This is 1 month longer than most schools in our state. That extra 4 weeks is very important to our success as a school system.
Superintendent Smith and others opposing the bill believe that it will take away from the local control communities and school districts are accustomed to.
It's a community level type of situation. So if it doesn't work,
it should be at least investigated whether the schools could save money and whether you could make a better environment for kids to learn.
Of course, if the kids had a say, summer would never come to an end, even as late as September. In Phoenix, Ryan Hale, Cronkite News.
House Bill 2303 is passed in both rules and education committees. We'll keep you up to date. And another bill released this session in the Senate could put one more thing on your phone and one less thing in your wallet. Cronkite News reporter Lauren Clenda met up with the senator behind the electronic license.
You can already put just about anything from your wallet onto your smartphone. You can pay with it, you can hold your insurance on it, and in a matter of years, you'll be able to take your driver's license and put it on it too.
So when this becomes your wallet, when this is how you buy everything, the natural extension of that is this is also a way to properly identify you.
Senate Bill 1237 was proposed by Senator Jeff Dial, using technology to give Arizona residents the option of carrying a virtual license.
I think in about 5 years from now, you'll see over half the states in the country, if not two-thirds or three-quarters of the states, have this out there, and you'll see it readily being accepted throughout societies.
ADOT is working with a vendor called Morpho Trust USA, who will create a template and help to implement the electronic licenses. The bill will ensure that handing your phone to an officer does not give them the right to access other content. It could also have the potential to stifle counterfeiting of Arizona IDs, and it would give an alternate way to show identification. But there are concerns that information won't be secure.
There's absolutely no way to 100% protect any system that's connected to the internet from breaches.
While security measures are still in the works, the hope is to show how advanced Arizona is with new technology.
The state of Arizona government, we're trying to stay up to speed, make it very consumer friendly, and I think this is a step in that direction.
If passed, you could see the new electronic licenses in the next 3 to 5 years. In Phoenix, Lauren Clenda, Cronkite News.
And now we have an update on two other bills that were making their way through the legislature this session. SB 1460 gave initial approval for a bill that would legalize weapons previously prohibited in Arizona. The bill attached the right to own sawed-off shotguns, silencers, and nunchucks into a minor bill that restores a person's gun rights if a guilty conviction is set aside. Democrats said the bill is now more about getting legalized weapons and not about helping people. The bill got initial approval Monday and awaits for a formal vote. SB 1445 was passed by a 23-6 vote yesterday and requires police departments to get an officer's permission before releasing their names to the public. The bill would still have to go through the state house before making it to the governor's desk. Some legislation is not as fortunate and won't make it out of the House and Senate. Some of the most notable bills include HB 2493, which would ban minors from using tanning beds, and those cameras flashing when you go through intersections aren't going away. The state Senate voted against SB 1167, which would eliminate photo radar across the state. Well, a study released today by the Morrison Institute revealed that Arizonans believe education and water should be the state's top two priorities in the legislature. I spoke with the associate director about these results and what it means for the future of Arizona.
Michael Meacham and his two kids spend a lot of time outdoors.
My son really likes waterfalls. I took him out into the national park and saw the Taunton Natural Bridge.
But in a few years, Michael's kids will trade in this Tuesday afternoon playtime for classroom time, something this father hopes is an easy transition.
Where is the best for them? And I've got to break down each school individually and go from there.
According to the Morrison Institute, the top two things Arizonans want the legislature to prioritize are K-12 education and water.
You know, if you live in a desert, you think about water.
David Doherty with the Morrison Institute says he doesn't find the survey results surprising. The poll ranked K-12 education and maintaining adequate water supply as Arizona's top priorities.
People generally are concerned about education, concerned about youth, concerned about making sure that that the next generation is well educated.
But for Michael,
they're still young. They're three, so I've got a couple years before I have to actually make that decision.
He has a different priority for that number one spot: his kids. The survey also ranked law enforcement and public safety as Arizonans' third priority. The lowest on the list, Arizona's prison system. The poll surveyed 754 Arizona adults.
And the Department of Homeland Security is nearing an important deadline.
Our Washington reporters have more on the budget debate that could cause a DHS shutdown.
And Cronkite News is continuing to track heroin addiction in the Valley. We take a look at a new vaccine that could help heroin addicts faster than ever before. The Senate tried for a fourth time and failed to vote on a budget last night for the Department of Homeland Security, which is about to run out of money. Cronkite News reporter Sierra Oshren is in Washington with what this could mean for you. Sierra?
If Congress can't reach an agreement by Friday at midnight, TSA, Secret Service, and Border Patrol agents are going to be the ones who have to make the sacrifice.
With just 3 days until the Department of Homeland Security runs out of money, Congress is still fighting over the language in the proposed budget.
One hates to see security of America being held hostage by politics.
Politics over the president's executive action that will protect 4 million undocumented immigrants. Republicans want to strip the funding for those actions from the budget, while Democrats are trying to keep it in. In the meantime, those who are securing our borders are going to have to pay the price.
The Border Patrol agents will still be patrolling. Even if their paychecks are delayed, they're considered still on the payroll and on duty.
But another 30,000 DHS employees would be sent home if Congress doesn't agree on a budget.
All the pieces do matter, so now those positions will have to be filled by Border Patrol agents who should be out enforcing the law and protecting our borders.
Giving the Border Patrol agents less time to focus on keeping our borders secure.
People that are responsible for border security are not the ones to blame.
And while the future remains uncertain,
God bless the defenders of our borders. No matter what, we're going to do our best to have their backs.
Senate Republicans said they are willing to allow separate votes on the president's plan and on the budget in hopes of moving things forward. But even if an agreement is reached, the budget would still have to go back to the House before Friday's deadline. Reporting live from Washington, D.C., Sierra Oshren, Cronkite News.
More than 200 school district superintendents in Arizona signed a letter opposing Governor Doug Ducey's state education budget. Cronkite News reporter Brittany Bade explains why Governor Ducey's Classrooms First initiative may not be what it seems.
We cut to the bone.
We've already cut the fat. Now we're down to the skin and bones.
School districts all over the state are strapped for cash.
It's either cutting skin or bones.
The Madison School District faces up to $750,000 in cuts, and the Chandler Unified School District could lose $6 million if the budget passes as is.
It's well intended that it be classrooms first in the budget proposal. It just takes money away from the districts. It doesn't put any money into the classroom.
The Madison School District faces up to $7,500,000 in cuts, and the Chandler Unified School District could lose $6 million if the budget passes as is.
He does recognize that
right now too much is being spent on the administration side. And so that's where the reductions are coming in.
But administration costs encompass more than you might think.
Things like counselors and librarians, school bus drivers, those kinds of things, security officers, really all the things that impact student achievement and creating a safe campus for our schools.
Some school districts say they are already being as efficient as possible.
We're using our resources best we can.
And another round of cuts like this would cause...
It is a conundrum.
A costly conundrum. In Phoenix, Brittany Bade, Cronkite News.
If the governor's budget passes as is, more than $113 million will be cut from schools statewide, according to some district analysis.
As part of Cronkite News' dedication to tracking the spread of heroin in Arizona, Cronkite News reporter Lauren Hanley spoke with researchers about a new way to help fight addiction.
In January, Cronkite News tracked the escalating problem of heroin use across Arizona with our documentary Hooked. While drugs like methadone are commonly used for treatment, there might be an even more powerful alternative.
With heroin addiction becoming epidemic across the United States, researchers at the Scripps Research Institute in California are developing a possible life-saving solution, a heroin vaccine. Dr. Kim Janda and his team at the Institute proved in preclinical trials on heroin-addicted mice that when given the vaccine and boosters, the mice did not relapse for at least 8 months. Even when they were given 10 times the average hit of heroin, or more recently 25 times as much, they showed no effects.
I think they are actually quite promising because there's no, very good drug to neutralize this, to block the addiction.
A local addiction vaccine researcher now specializing in nicotine at the Arizona State University Biodesign School explained that such a vaccine would work like a sponge in the body, stopping heroin molecules from even reaching the brain.
So essentially they sequester those small molecules in the blood circulation, prevent their entry into the brain.
When Susie Churchill of Tempe read about the vaccine, she said she wished it had been available for her 22-year-old nephew who died last year of a heroin overdose.
If that was there for my nephew, he would have jumped on it. He would have jumped on it because he didn't want to be an addict.
Janda and his team at the Institute still need more proof of its safety before it can be FDA approved for a clinical trial in humans, but they need money. Paul Bremer says the National Institutes of Health has been reluctant to give them more funding.
We haven't seen anything like this before, so hopefully we can convince them at some point that it is working and that it is more efficacious than anything else that we've seen.
In our documentary Hooked, Cronkite News reported that more 21 to 23-year-olds overdosed on heroin since 2009 than any other age group. Now, this research could be proved to be a way to help stop heroin's hold on Arizona. Live in the Broadcast Center, Lauren Hanley, Cronkite News.
Cutting carbon emissions, but costing Arizona.
See why the EPA's plan for coal power plants is igniting debate.
The more you know about history, the more you know about yourself.
Let's turn the page.
I believe that this nation should commit itself.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
You can almost divide American history before Robinson and after Robinson.
Seeing is believing. We broke records. We broke barriers.
This is incredible.
Suddenly the big picture makes more sense.
We have unprecedented access.
Now I can see my ancestors. Now I'm looking into their world. Now I can see where they walked.
Fossil fuels such as coal and natural gas are proven to pollute the air. Cronkite News reporter Sydney Schumann is here. Sydney, how is the Environmental Protection Agency trying to reduce these harmful emissions?
Well, in June, the EPA put out a draft of their Clean Power Plan, which could cause fossil fuel power plants nationwide to shut down. The Clean Power Plan doesn't specifically require fossil fuel power plants to shut down, but sets carbon emission reduction goals for each state.
The concern we have about this particular plan is it's asking Arizona to do a lot very quickly.
Arizona needs to reduce its emissions by 52% by the year 2020.
The targets for Arizona are so aggressive, the way they're currently proposed, they essentially would force you to shut down your coal plants and possibly some of the natural gas sooner rather than later.
According to a study by the Arizona Department of Environmental Quality and the Corporation Commission, forcing Arizona to reduce its emissions in such a short amount of time could cost the state $3 billion.
A lot of our energy needs can be met through reducing energy use with efficiency measures.
Sandy Barr with the environmental group The Sierra Club says the state needs to look to other options.
Doing a little bit more to clean up the air, reduce emissions that cause climate change, in the end, it will save us money.
But Montalvo says Arizona already has clean air and it continues to get cleaner.
Over the last 20 years, more than 80% reduction in sulfur dioxide emissions, probably about half in nitrogen oxide emissions. Carbon emissions has been a little bit slower path, but we've made some good improvements there as well.
The EPA took in millions of public comments through December and is currently in the process of reviewing them in order to develop a finalized plan sometime this summer. But Arizona will not be able to start creating its own implementation plan right away. That's because state lawmakers need to pass a bill giving the Arizona Department of Environmental Quality the explicit authority to do so. Live in the broadcast center, Sydney Schumann, Cronkite News.
It's time to get those jackets out again because Arizona is cooling back down. Casey Brecker has your weather forecast for the week.
Yes, it's cooling down here in Phoenix, and we're having heavy winds right now. But as we take a closer look, you can see that we have a low pressure system moving out towards the east. And as the evening continues, it's going to keep moving out towards the east. It's causing a slight chance of rain, but it's supposed to dry up here in the valley as time goes on tonight. Although right now in Phoenix, you can see it's a little bit chilly at 65 degrees, and we have those gusty winds of 12 miles per hour today, so watch out for that. As we take a look at the state overall, it's pretty chilly. Up north, we have a high of 38 degrees in Flagstaff, and down south in Tucson, we have a high of 58 degrees. And it's only going to get a little bit colder tonight here in Phoenix. It's dropping down to 45 degrees and it's going to be mostly clear. So make sure tonight to bring out those jackets, especially since it's going to be a little bit below average. As we take a look at the highs tomorrow, it's warming up here in Phoenix. It's going to be sunny and beautiful. It's 74 degrees. Up north, it's going to head up into the 50s. So it's just going to be a little bit warmer tomorrow. As we take a look at our five-day forecast, you can see sunny and beautiful Wednesday and Thursday in the 70s. As we move into Saturday and Sunday, though, over the weekend, we're expecting a storm system to be moving into Phoenix. We have a 30% chance of rain on Saturday and a 20% chance on Sunday with temperatures dropping into the 60s. So make sure to stay warm this weekend and grab those umbrellas just in case. For your Cronkite weather, I'm Casey Brecker.
Coming up, the release of a new application for Phoenix residents will allow them to see where their tax dollars are going and what resources are available to them in their area.
At ASU, we believe the most important semester is the one that starts after you get your diploma, the one called life. So we work hard to help our alumni thrive, teaching them the importance of not only achieving their goals, but exceeding them. With innovative programs that embrace hands-on learning, that encourages real-world growth. Our alumni know it can be the education of a lifetime, for a lifetime. For more information, thrive.asu.edu.
Should I believe in the world, Mama?
I think so.
Should I give up and hide, or should I stay and fight? Should I believe in the rules, Mama?
What are the consequences?
Speak out my mind in these changing times. I don't know what to believe.
Will you march with us?
There's a fire inside. There's a storm on the rise. Give me a reason to be, Mama.
Buonasera.
Is more complicated than it's ever been.
The news hour is always going to take you deeper and take you broader.
And that is worth fighting for.
Night after night, 7 days a week.
I'm Maria Hinojosa.
I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff.
On behalf of all of us here,
Thanks for watching.
Cronkite News is proud to join the Arizona PBS News Block here on 8 HD.
Here's a look at what's coming up tonight on Arizona Horizon and PBS News Hour.
Coming up after Cronkite News, it's Arizona Horizon. The new Morrison Cronkite poll is out. We'll take a look at the questions and the survey results, and we'll look at Art Detour, a Phoenix tradition and one of the largest art walks in the country.
I'm Gwen Ifill on the next News Hour. The deadline nears to reach a deal to fund the Department of Homeland Security.
In another attempt to advance Phoenix technologically, the city has released a new map application. It allows users to see what resources are available to them in the city. Cronkite News reporter Lauren Klenda is in the media center to show us how it works.
Whether you're a Phoenix resident or just visiting, the app is available to everyone and easy to use. To access the app, type in phoenix.gov/imap in your search bar. From there, you can launch the app and type in the address of your destination. Users can easily see what city sites and resources are around them, such as emergency services like fire departments, police stations, or hospitals. You can also see what schools are in the area, where transit services are, and other general resources. The app allows you to select the service you're looking for, click the Map It button, and then get directions.
We still have work to do, but that keeps us motivated, and it's always good to have a goal. So I think in another 2, 3, 4 years, this product may be so interactive and useful that it goes beyond our expectations.
The city hopes to continue to advance the app in years to come, making it more interactive and adding real-time data. Live in the Media Center, Lauren Klenda, Cronkite News.
Have a good night.
Thanks for joining us.